Welcome to module 15 of point set topology part 1. Last time we did something about the closure of a set and closed sets, right? So similar thing we will try to do for interior of a set and boundaries of a set and such things. Okay? So most of them are similar in nature, but you have to be a little more careful, that's all. So similar what? Similar to what we have done for closures. But you have to be a little more careful, that's all. So start with a topological space again. A and B are any two subsets of X. Then I have these seven properties here listed. The first one is interior of empty is empty. It is similar to closure of empty set is empty. And interior of X is the whole of X. Again, closure of X was X. It's similar to that, right? So there is some similarity, but don't get carried away. You have to be very careful. Interior of A is contained in A. In the case of closure, it was A was contained in the closure of A. Okay. So this is also easy because by the very definition, what is the definition of interior? It is the union of all open sets contained in A. So each open set is contained in A, their union will be also contained in A. So that is A interior. A contained in B implies A interior is contained in B interior. This is similar to the closure property, by the way. So how do we prove that? A interior is all those open sets union, all those open sets contained in A. But then they will be contained in B also. So they will be contained in B interior. Okay, because B interior is all those open sets contained in B, you have to take and then take the open, then take the union, right? So this is also obvious. Finally, A is open if and only if A is a closure. Okay, so this is similar to A is closed if and only if A is a closure. Here, A is open if and only A is interior. A is equal to A interior. Okay. So why if A is equal to A interior is always an open set because it's a union of open sets. So A will be open. If A is open, this is the largest open set already. All other open sets are already there. So I have to take this also. That will be interior, right? So A will be equal to A interior. B interior is the largest open set contained in B. So this is somewhat, you know, complementary to similar, but complementary to the closure. Closure was what? The closure of a set is the smallest closed set containing that B. So it is exactly, you know, like a Jim Morgan law, exactly the opposite of B interior is the largest open set contained in B. Okay, I could have put A here, but deliberately I have put it here, you will see. So B interior is open set, we know. Suppose you have another open set contained in B, but then B interior is the union of all such things, so it is contained B. It is contained inside B interior. So B interior is the largest open set. So these are all just restatements of whatever we have done. They are not very difficult. Slowly, you have to be careful. Interior of A intersection B is interior of A intersection interior of B. Here again, interior of anything is an open set, right? And it is contained in the A intersection B here. Therefore, it is contained in A. therefore it's contained in the interior of A. But same argument will swap for interior B also, so it's contained in the intersection. So this is contained in the this side, LHS contained in RHS is obvious. Now how to show this is contained here? Look at this one. Interior of A is an open set. Interior of B is an open set. The intersection is an open set. Interior of A is contained in A. Okay, so this intersection is also contained inside A. Interior of B is contained inside B, so its intersection is contained inside B. But it's an open set, so it's contained in the interior of A intersection. Okay. So this last one here, interior of A union B contains the interior of A union B. So there is no equality assertion here. Okay. It's only one way, and that is obvious because interior of A is a subset of A, right? So it's a subset of A union B. Similarly, this subset of A union B. So this whole thing is a subset of A union B. But this is an open set, being the union of two open sets. Therefore, it's contained in interior of A. So one way is clear. Further, if A and B are disjoint open sets or disjoint closed sets. Disjointness is common. Both of them are open or both of them are closed. That's what you have to assume. Okay, then equality holds. So let us see this one. So all these things I have written down here. Okay, starting with the definition. What is the definition was this one? That A, interior of A, is the union of all open sets contained in A. This is a definition. So you can take different definitions, then your proofs may be somewhat slightly different. Okay, that's all. I have taken this definition, I have done. Okay, so I have gone through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on up to here. Interior of A, intersection interior of B. Seventh one, one part we saw. Okay. First part directly from 3. Now I want to show the second part here. Namely, suppose A intersection B is empty. Okay. If both A and B are open, then the union is also open. Therefore, interior of A union B, A union B is already open. So interior of B, you know, A interior A union B. But A is interior of A. B is interior of B because A and B are open. So equality is obvious. All right. So perhaps you have not used the intersection is empty here at all, right? Now suppose both A and B are closed. This time you may have to use that. Huh? All right. Suppose both A and B are closed subsets and I have assumed A intersection B is empty. Let U be an open set contained in the union. Okay. Suppose U is an open subset contained in the union. If I have to show that interior of this one is equal to interior of A union interior of B, I must show that this open set, first of all, is contained in the interior of A union interior of B separately. So, first of all, you can write this U as union of two subsets here. One is U intersection complement of B and U intersection complement of A. This is possible only because A intersection B is empty. A intersection B is empty would mean that the complements of A and complement of B will be the whole space. Therefore, every set is contained in the whole space. So it is U intersection complement of B, U intersection complement of A, take the union. This is true for all subsets now because B complement and A complement is the whole space. Okay, whole set. It is just a set theoretic thing right now. So for that I have to use A intersection B is empty. Now how do I use this one? U is now written as union of two two sets here as union of two open sets. U is open, B is closed, B complement is open, intersection is open. A complement is open, intersection is open. So I actually, this one gives you that U is the union of two open sets respectively. This one is inside A now because it's the B complement is there. And A intersection B is empty. Okay. So one of them must be inside A, the other one must be inside B. Okay. So that means that U intersection B complement is contained in interior of A, and U intersection A complement is contained in interior of B. Therefore, U is in the interior of A, union interior of B. This proves that one way, namely interior of A union B is contained in the interior of A, union interior of B. Okay? The other way we already see. Okay. So similar thing we will do for now the boundary operator. Take any subset of a topological space. Boundary of the empty set is empty. Boundary of the whole space is also empty, not the whole space X. So this is the difference now, okay? So recall, what is the boundary? Boundary of a set is the closure of A minus the interior of A. Throw away all the interior points from the closure of A. Keep that is boundary of A, okay? So closure is the whole space. If A is X, then X bar is X. Interior is also X, so X minus X is empty set. So that's what the first thing says here. Second one says a point X is a boundary point of A if and only if every neighborhood U of X intersects both A and A complement. Okay. All right. Take a neighborhood of a point. All right. If that neighborhood, I have to show it intersects both of them. If it does not intersect the complement, means what? That neighborhood is completely contained inside A, right? Which means that point is an interior point, but I have thrown away the interior points from boundary, right? A point is a boundary only if it is in the complement, first of all, of your interior points. No interior point is a boundary point. All right. Similarly, argument is similar here. If it does not, suppose it does not intersect A, then it will be contained in the complement of A, right? If it does not intersect A, then it is contained in complement of A. Right? If it is containing the complement of A, then it is in the interior of the complement. Right? Therefore, it is not a boundary point at all. Because boundary point, every point should intersect the set A. Right? So this argument is similar here. Similarly, now interchanging A and A bar, it seems the boundary of A equal boundary of a complement also. So this statement is symmetric. So this is also boundary of A is always equal to boundary of the complement. All right. Okay. The fourth statement is boundary of A is a closed subset. That's also equally easy because what is boundary of set? It is A bar minus A interior, which is the same thing as writing A bar intersection with A interior complement. A interior is open. So its complement is closed. Then you are taking intersection with A bar. That's also closed. So intersection of two closed sets is closed. So that's what we want to show. Okay, so each boundary A is a closed set. Finally, boundary of A union B is contained in boundary of A union boundary of B. This thing I will leave to you as an exercise. Because I have done so many things, you have to do something on your own to get the feeling what is going on. So you have to start with, I will just tell you how to do it. Take a point here, you have to show it is either here or here. So what you have to do? Take a point here, which is not here, then it must be here. This is what you have to do. This kind of argument also we have used already, right? So write the full detail as an exercise. The second part, I will do it here. If A intersection B is empty, and both A and B are open or both are closed, it is similar to our interior part, then the equality holds. Okay? I can leave this also an exercise, but I will do this one so that you are not feeling that I am cheating. Okay? So we shall leave the first part as an exercise. To do the second part, I have to assume that A and B are disjoint. Once they are disjoint, the first thing you have to note is this one. A intersection B is empty implies A intersection interior B is also empty. Because interior B is smaller subset. Similarly, interior of A intersection B is also empty. So this also, because this is smaller subset than A. So this is just set theoretic because interiors are contained in the original set. But now this implies, we have seen in the closure part, that the closure of A intersection interior B is empty because interior B is an open set. Whenever an open set does not intersect the closure. That's what we have seen. So from here to here, you get this also empty. From here to here, you get intersection interior of A intersection closure of B is empty because interior of A is open. So this is all that I can say right from the assumption that A intersection B is empty. Okay. Now let us start. The first thing is interior of the union contains interior of A, union interior of B. This we have seen. Okay. So boundary of A union B, which is by definition closure of the A union B minus the interior, right? Now, closure of the union, finite union, only two sets, is closure of A, union closure of B. And this one is, this is smaller, indeed of this one is larger than this one. So I have thrown away a larger set. Here I am throwing a smaller set. So I have a containment relation here, not equality. Interior of throwing this one, you throw interior of A, union interior of B, which is smaller set. Okay? So this is contained in here, though this is contained in here because you are taking the complementation. This is the minus. Okay? Once you have here, look at interior of A, this is a subset of closure of A. Okay? And I have just shown that interior of A does not intersect closure of B at all. So when I'm subtracting this one from the union, I'm actually subtracting it only from closure of A. So it is closure of A minus interior of A. Similarly, when you are throwing interior of B, it's only thrown away from here. No point of this one comes there. So this union is closure union minus the union of these two is equal to this minus this union, this minus. This follows because of this relation. All right? You have proved that. But this is boundary of A and that is boundary of B. So what you have, what A, boundary of A union B is contained in the boundary of A union boundary of B. Okay? Now I put one more hypothesis. What is the hypothesis? That A and B are both open or both closed. That is the extra hypothesis here. A and B are both open or both closed. In that case, we have proved in the previous theorem that what we have proved in the last part of the previous theorem, that interior of A union B is actually equal to interior of A union theorem B. Right? Remember that. This is a statement here. Okay, then equality holds. Right? So, once equality holds, go back to these steps. There are four steps here. The second step was only containment. Why? Because here there was no equality. This was continuous. If there is an equality here, I can put equality here. Then everything else is done. Got it? So one equality comes, extra comes instead of this one, provided both A and B are closed or both are open. So this containment becomes equality. And all other things are equality. All right. So now I will sum up something, namely open sets were the foundations for our definition of topology, right? The topology was axiomatized on depending upon open sets. There is a parallel we have already observed, because De Morgan law is there, and then you can just convert all these three statements T, AU, and what? FI. AU is arbitrary union, FI is finite intersection. When you take the complements of this by De Morgan law, the first statement remains as it is, empty set and the whole space become whole space and empty set, that's all. The second one, arbitrary union for open sets becomes what? Arbitrary intersections for open sets, for closed sets. And then finite union for open sets, or for closed sets, sorry, finite intersection for open sets becomes finite union for closed sets. So you could have defined the same way with three axioms for closed sets, right? But that would be cheating. What Kuratowski did was even more entertaining. At the time when Bourbaki adopted a modified version of the axioms for topology, okay, that is the definition we have been taking, okay, this result was only the correct definition available. What I am talking about, the Kuratowski's result. Yet for some reason, which I don't know what it is, they rejected Kuratowski's approach and adopted a modification of Hausdorff's definition. If you directly take Hausdorff's definition, you don't get all topological spaces as we consider, because Hausdorff has put extra conditions, which will come to what are called Hausdorff spaces. So they dropped out that one. But instead of dropping out the whole Hausdorff, just dropped out that condition retained. Okay, so let us take a look at this Kuratowski's approach here. Maybe it is of some use, okay, gives you some more insight, that's all. But we will not change our definition. Our definition of topology depends upon open sets. All right, let us do that. Let X be any set. And C from Px to Px be a operator. Operator is just a self map. Okay, don't worry about, usually this word operator is used by function analysis. Okay, so Px to Px be an operator on the power set of X. Px is power set. It's a function from power set to power set. Suppose this operator satisfies the following properties. These properties are called Kuratowski's closure axioms. Okay, the first thing says that the let me read that C as closure itself now. Okay, just for the sake, that is how Kuratowski read it. But we have a different meaning for closure right now. But let me just for this, let us just C of E instead of C of E, I say closure of E is V. Remember, this was a property we have proved. Okay. So here it becomes an axiom in terms of for Kuratowski. There is no topology here now. There is an operator, a set is there, and look at the all its subsets. On that, there is an operator. So the first thing is closure of V is V. Whatever you assigned to empty set, it's empty set. Okay. Whatever you assigned to A in general contains A. A is contained inside CA for every A. C of A union B is CA union CB. If I read the closure, what is it? Closure of A union B is closure of A and closure of B. We have proved it. This is a theorem there. Here it is an axiom. This is true for every AP. C of CA is CA. This also we have proved, right? Closure of a closure is the closure itself. So this is an axiom again here. And that's it. The four axioms he has selected, he can create the entire topology. That is the claim of Kuratowski. Okay? So how does he do that? Put tau C instead of tau, take tau C. C corresponds to this closure axiom. All those U inside Px, okay, that means what? All subsets of X such that the complement of this one, C of the complement, is equal to C itself. So put all of them, the complements of that one, they form a topology on X. And this topology has something to do with C. What is that? The usual definition of closure A bar is equal to C of A for all A. So this C becomes the closure. That's why it's called closure operator. Okay. So when I read it first time, I was really thrilled by this one. So let us verify this one. It is very straightforward, not at all difficult. So let us write FC instead of tau C, FC as all those A's are set A equal to CA. So what is tau C? Remember, it's a complement of these things. That is tau C. Tau C is a topology you have to verify. Just now I have told you by De Morgan law, instead of tau, instead of T, I have to verify T prime, but that is T is T prime. Instead of AU, AU, I have to, AU prime is nothing but, this is now AI, that means arbitrary intersection. And instead of finite intersection, I have to use finite union, because under De Morgan law, intersection becomes union and so on. So I have to verify these three axioms for FC. Okay. Then tau C will verify T, AU and FU, and that's why it's topology. So first part will be over. So let us verify these two. The first T is nothing but T prime, is nothing but closure of empty set is empty, and that is what's already there. Therefore, empty set is there, MC. But X is already contained in CX, but CX cannot be bigger than X because they are all subsets of X. So equality holds here. Therefore, X is in CX. Therefore, X is in FC. So tau prime is verified. Okay? This T prime is verified. Sorry. If A and B are in FC, I have to C of A union B, C A union CB. Therefore, C A is A, CB is B because they are in FC. So C of A union B is in, so A union B is in FC. So this verifies finite union. I have to show arbitrary intersection. Take any family F alpha, A alpha inside FC. Inside FC means what? C of A alpha equal to A alpha for every alpha. Then I have to show the same property for the intersection. This is what I have to show. Okay. No problem. First, we use another property. We derive. This is not a part of the axiom. This we are proving as a consequence. What is that? If A is contained inside B, then CA is contained inside CB. Why? Write B. B is a larger set, right? As A union B minus A. If you write this way, then apply the operator C. Operator CB, C is of the union, is CA, union C of B minus A. But CA is there, so CA is contained inside CB, that's all. Whatever happens to CB minus A, don't care. Okay. So, A contained is B implies CA is contained CB. But the intersection is contained in every alpha, A alpha. Therefore, its closure here is contained in closure of each of them, C of A alpha. But C of A alpha is A alpha. Right? So, this closure is contained here, but this is equal to A alpha. So if it is contained inside A alpha for every alpha, it is contained in the intersection. So closure of the intersection is contained in the intersection, but intersection is contained in always closure, because for intersection, for any set, is contained in its closure. So these two are there, so there must be equality. These two are same, right? So there is equality. So This proves the first part. I will leave the second part, namely A bar equal to CA. Just a very nice, you know, just think about it. It's not difficult at all. In this topology, you have to prove that A bar equal to CA for all A. So that I will leave it as an exercise to you. Okay? Here are some exercises about pseudo-metric. Just to tell you what is definition, okay, D1 is not there, that's all. A metric satisfies D1, D2, D3, remember, D1 was the positive definiteness, that is missing. D2 is symmetry, D3 is triangle inequality. Only these two are there. All other things are working exactly same. No problem. Okay. You can put a tau d, namely the topology associated to these things. What are they? They are unions of balls, open balls. Open balls, etc. All these things are same. Same way you have to carry on. Okay. So that becomes a topology. You have to do that. You show that D is a metric if and only if in this topology tau D, okay, every singleton is closed. So that is the first exercise. This part is easy. You can put the topology and so on. So that I am not bothered about. First, you have to show this, observe this one. This is also not difficult, observe this one. The second part is put an equivalence relation D of XY equal to 0, then X is related to Y. See, if it is a metric, DXY equal to 0 would have implied that X is equal to Y. Since it is only a pseudo-metric, you don't know whether X is equal to Y. That's why you want to identify them. So you put an equivalence relation. If you put a relation, now you check that it is an equivalence relation. For that, you know, all that you have to do is symmetry, D2 you have to use, D3 you have to use, it's very easy. Look at the equivalence classes. That is my notation X hat here, denote the equivalence classes. On each equivalence class, I am denoting by this bracket text, bracket Y and so on. So I am defining a map from X hat cross X hat into 0 infinity by this formula, D of X bracket, Y bracket equal D of XY. I am just putting this formula, but why this is well defined, you have to check. Next, you have to show that now this D hat here, there is a hat here, okay? D hat becomes a metric on X hat. Okay, so the associated to a pseudo metric space and a pseudo metric, there is a metric space, okay, which is the quotient of this X, because equivalence relations are there. That is the gist of this one. Verify this one. There is all these things we have to verify. So there is a similar exercise here about when you have union of increasing sequence of union of subsets. X is countable increasing sequence of subsets. Xn minus 1 contains Xn and so on. On each Xn, you have a pseudo metric Dn. Okay, actually, sorry, Dn's are metric pseudo metrics on X, on the defined on the whole of X. When you restrict it to Xn, it's a metric. Only when XY are inside Xn, Dn of XY equal to 0 implies X equal to Y. If you go out of that into X, that relation is not there, that's all. So on X, they are all pseudo metrics. Restricted to Xn, they are all metrics. Suppose that is the case, then you do this funny thing. This is a typical way of summing up infinite things, okay? Inside a, when you have infinitely many real number, only thing you have to assume that all the Dn's are bounded by one single number. I have assumed bounded by one, doesn't matter. Bounded by one single number is enough. Define delta xy equal to this summation of dn of xy by 2 power n. It's bounded by m divided by 2 power n summation, that is convergent, so this is also convergent. So this will be finite number. This has wonderful properties now. This delta will become a metric on X, okay, and it has some wonderful properties. All these you have to verify, namely, a sequence in X is Cauchy with respect to this delta if and only if it's Cauchy with respect to each Dn, okay. So the topology is very closely related, that's what it means. Okay, so let us meet next time. Thank you.